it's, I think, very difficult to conceive what the consequences of a mass revolution would be. Clearly, it doesn't appear that an evolutionary process without major reforms could indeed lead to a better distribution of resources. So the question is, what are the kinds of reforms which might be required? Now, I'm not going to go into it, but if you read the Brand Commission report, you find that they make a number of recommendations with regard to the type of reform. Now, my feeling is that the issue in the North is not presently the question of trying to come up with a formulation of these theoretical principles and reform, such as, for instance, a progressive world income tax. The chances of such an income tax being politically acceptable are totally inexistent at the present time. It doesn't have the slightest chance of acceptance. So the question is not to come up with a series of possible reforms, but rather of fostering a climate of public opinion which is going to be receptive to the underlying principles of future reforms. First of all, I think this climate has to be created. It is essential to convince the various socioeconomic groups in the North that it is going to be to their advantage to undertake a certain number of reforms which will, I think, achieve a more equal income distribution between the North and the South. And this brings me to the last part of my presentation, and this is an attempt at making a few modest suggestions, which I feel, nevertheless, if they were undertaken, might greatly improve the prospects for these reforms. Now, the first suggestion which I have is the need for educating public opinion in the US, in Western Europe, regarding the form and the extent of interdependence in the world economy, as well as the enormous dangers which would follow from a continuation of this trend towards inequality between the North and the South. If the average citizen could be made to see the mutuality of interests between the two blocks and the likely fruits of greater cooperation, even if these fruits might ripen only much later, a commitment to development cooperation in the North and actual reforms could in fact follow. Now, how does one educate public opinion? The greater commitment to development cooperation must be clearly presented. In particular, I think a convincing case has to be made that we know enough now about this process of economic and social development that a continued progress towards poverty alleviation is indeed possible. It's not only possible, but it is likely. It's essential that we do this to remove the kind of black despair, the kind of fatalism which many people in the North feel about the future prospects, let's say, of a malnourished child in India or in the Sahel. When you see these programs on television, it's very easy to get quite discouraged and become very fatalistic. Now, in order to make such a case that we really know enough to do something about the situation, I think it's essential to encourage a process of multidisciplinary research, because basically the nature of the development process does not lie in one discipline, but a successful marriage, a successful combination of different disciplines. Now, this brings me to my next suggestion, which is very much interrelated with the last one, and which I think is very relevant for Iowa State University, and this is that universities in the developed world have a major responsibility for undertaking such a multidisciplinary research program, since the essence of the economic and social development process consists of the complex of interaction between a variety of forces, economic forces, sociological forces, demographic forces, elements having to do with nutrition, health, medicine, agriculture, technology, and many other fields of inquiries. Now, where do you find a competence in these various disciplines in one place? Well, obviously in a university, and Iowa State has a long tradition of multidisciplinary research, which I think it could very successfully, and has to some extent already successfully, applied to problems of economic and agricultural development. Now, let me give you one example of one illustration of the operation of an interactive system which would be based on these different disciplines. Greater production, say of wheat or of rice in traditional agriculture, is going to lead to larger incomes accruing to these small farmers, small traditional farmers, and normally to better nutrition and to better health. Now, better health is going to reduce mortality almost immediately. But in turn, improved nutrition and a higher level of income will have a delayed effect on reducing fertility and thereby the birth rate, and one of the forces which has led to poverty, namely this population explosion. And you can go on along these lines and indicate the complex feedback system which exists and which can never be analyzed within the confines of any specific discipline. The compartmentalization of knowledge, which I think characterizes so many studies, so many areas of studies today, very often arbitrarily fills a set of little and sometimes not so little boxes with knowledge which appears to be totally unconnected. Now, this approach to scientific discovery may be defensible in a number of clear-cut physical and biological sciences, and of course may be necessary in these sciences, but conflicts directly with the advance of knowledge in the development area. Now, the promotion of multidisciplinary research teams focused on concrete development problems may lead to a number of major breakthroughs in our understanding of the operation of the system. Concrete answers might be generated which could yield policy recommendations, recommendations for policy actions by governments in both the developed and the developing countries. Now, such a factual, empirical approach might in turn be the most effective way to fight ideologies, which are based on doctrines and faith rather than on facts obtained from testable hypotheses. Now, having said all of this, I think I should introduce a note of caution, and this is that having been involved in a number of these types of multidisciplinary projects, I realize fully how difficult it is to make them succeed. Every discipline has its own language and taxonomy. The more esoteric the field, the greater the walls which surround it and preclude outsiders, however talented and imaginative they might be, from entering inside of them and communicating with the few high priests who master the prevailing paradigm. Compromises have to be made, individuals have to learn to express themselves in terms that even neophytes can grasp, and slowly the walls, I think, can get broken down, and a new common language can be learned, and the quality of the research output might then benefit from this cross-fertilization, the alternative being, of course, cross-sterilization. Now, the impact of an improved empirical and to some extent inductive understanding of the development process, if it is clearly presented to the masses of the people in the developed world, could, I think, turn around public opinion in the industrialized world from this deep pessimist that we mentioned before to a more sober and perhaps a more objective optimism regarding the prospects of improving the lot of the poor in the South, while simultaneously improving the lot of the people in the North because of this tremendous interdependence. Now, I know that it's unrealistic to assume that the people in the developed world can be swayed to vote for measures which are supposed to benefit the third world on purely humanitarian grounds without any evidence that positive results which will follow and consequent quid pro quos with consequent quid pro quos for themselves. But hopefully the type of research which we mentioned before might demonstrate the benefits, might really convince through evidence that in the medium term and perhaps in the long term, benefits will accrue to the North and not just to the South. And I think it is in this fashion that a larger constituency for development cooperation might be built and the necessary reforms undertaken. Now, there's just a final point that I'd like to make, and you've been very patient, I've talked too long, and this is that there is one principle which I think is quite fundamental and which is easily forgotten, and this is the what one could call the democratic criterion. In a democracy, every individual has one vote and has an equal right on the decisions being reached, at least in principle. Now, I think the final question that I would like to leave with you is, will the North be ready to accept this principle at the global level? In other words, that each and every individual should have in some way an equal voice or an equal opportunity to be heard in matters affecting the globe. Acceptance of this democratic criterion is an ethical matter which of course cannot be forced. However, it is just possible, and here maybe I'm becoming somewhat utopian, it is just possible that through increasing interdependence, greater knowledge of the lot of the poor gained through research and mass communication, the distinction between a native, rich human being and a poor foreigner will become somewhat less clear-cut. I think it is conceivable that someday in the future we might develop at least a collective sense of responsibility for a landless worker in India, never to the extent that we may feel for our neighbor, but at least we will recognize his existence. Well, I've raised many issues and questions, and I've answered very few of them. And of course, I apologize for this. However, my talk may have been worthwhile if these questions generated certain seeds, let's say, in your mind, which will bear more profound insights than I've been able to give you. And this is the way I would like to leave it. And I would like to again thank you very much for having invited me. It was really a pleasure being back, and I can't wait for the next opportunity. Thank you very much.
Dr. Thorbecke will be glad to answer any questions you have for the next 20 minutes or so.
Yes?
Eric, you seem to suggest that probably that world civilization will not do well given this continual loss in the case of developing countries. I suppose one could make the case that we have sometimes been more fearful of countries, say, India or China, which is so heavily burdened, than turned out to be the situation. I wondered if there is, in the current situation, in India or China or Mexico or countries like this, some scenario that suggests that we have reason, highly industrialized countries do have reason in the long run to be worried about their own existence by virtue of the situation.
Well, it seems that we are in agreement. If I understand the point that you made, it seems to me that what has happened, at least since the Second World War, is that the extent of interdependence among countries has increased for a number of reasons. The tremendous population growth has put greater pressures on natural resources. The demands on these natural resources on the environment have increased, which means that to a much lesser extent than in the past, we can ignore some of the developments which take place very far from our own shores. Now, clearly, when it comes to questions of energy, for instance, the impact of a tremendous increase in the price of oil will have some very major consequences on the development of countries which are dependent on oil imports. And in fact, if you look at the balance of payments of countries like India, which are very dependent on oil imports, you see that they have worsened drastically. And to the extent that this in itself has implication for the growth of India, it is going to have indirect consequences for the capacity of India or the Indias of this world, Brazil, Mexico, to repay past debts. Mexico is having very serious problems at the present time, and interestingly enough, not because it is dependent on oil imports, but because it overestimated the royalties which would be generated from within. It seems to me that what is happening is that the extent of the interdependency has become much more serious in the possible consequences that it can have worldwide.
There are a number of historians, most notably Christopher Dawson, who have implied or explicitly said that economic development in the third world will also bring about a certain price in terms of cultural change. I was wondering how you might respond to that. Do you feel that cultural change is inevitable?
Oh, yes, I would say definitely. But I would ask a counter question. And the question would be the following: when you do have countries in which 200 million people might be, which is bound to have certain impact on the value system, they might become more market oriented. Even the small traditional farmer is going to market a certain proportion of his or her crop. Now, if these changes in the value system are necessary changes in order to improve the standard of living of these people who are so poor, then it seems to me that this is a price worth paying. If the alternative is to say, well, we don't want to do anything that is going to alter the value system, and if the consequence of doing this is a continuation, if not a worsening, of poverty in these countries, then it seems to me that this is not a very defensible position to take. And I mean, I personally have argued this with cultural anthropologists. I mean, cultural anthropologists, at least the one from the past generation, would often take the position that nothing should be done to affect the value systems of the people they observed. And this is all very nice, but it seems to me that you ought to some extent to give a choice to individuals. And it is true that people who are malnourished may not fully realize some of the consequences of accepting certain improvements, certain changes in the system. But it is certainly not for us to say that we should not offer them this alternative. Well, this goes way beyond the World Bank. I mean, this goes to the heart of having an international monetary system which really operates. And the World Bank is only one agency which, in fact, only provides project loans and does very little in terms of program loans or balance of payments loans. So it's really much more the International Monetary Fund, as well as a restructuring of the international monetary system. Today, I think we are really in between two systems. We've abandoned the gold standard, which imposed a certain degree of discipline on countries. After the Second World War, we moved to a system which still had some of the discipline, not as much as a gold standard, but some of the discipline of the gold standard. Now we've abandoned that, and we really are in need of a new system which, in a way, could control the tremendous amount of lending which takes place among countries. Now, I think that sooner or later something has to happen. If one see the number of countries today which have gone through a process of debt rescheduling, of rolling over debt, it seems to me that if you look at the large developing countries, Mexico, Brazil, Argentina, even some of the poorer countries, India, Pakistan, continuously the debt is being rolled over. The international agencies, lending agencies, the commercial banks, knowing that if they take too hard a line, will risk having these countries be in default, will turn around and say, okay, we'll lend you some funds for another 5 years. The term of the maturity of the past loans is going to be extended by another 5 years or another 7 years or what have you. Now, this cannot go on forever, obviously. And it seems to me that sooner or later, certain changes in the international monetary system will have to be found out to create a situation where this discipline, this financial discipline is created. The alternative is mass defaults, which would throw a real shock wave through the world economy.
Yeah. As you look at the foreign aid history, one thing I would say, there's been so many the independence of most of the third world countries aid us in foreign independence, yet, if anything, some of the economies have not been doing as well as they ought to be doing, you know, given the fact that they have all this income from the north. So, what is your assessment of foreign aid in the third world countries? I mean, what would you do different, either in the north or in the south, or would you recommend for both two parties to either in the north or the south? What's your assessment?
Yeah, it's, you know, this is a very open-ended question, and it probably would take more than the few minutes that I have to answer it. But I do agree with an inference in your question, which is that aid has had too many strings attached to it. And what one of the consequences of it is that it reduces the effectiveness, the efficiency of the aid. If, let's say, the United States only lends, if these countries buy in the United States, or if Germany only lends on condition that the aid again be spent in Germany, it means that the developing countries lose an opportunity to purchase the goods which they need in the country where these goods can be obtained the most cheaply. So in a way, it promotes a form of bilateralism as opposed to multilateralism, which in a way is also a form of protection. You give to somebody or you lend to somebody and you say, but you have to spend it with me at terms that I decide upon. So this clearly is not very desirable, and I think that the consequences of untying foreign aid would not be very serious for the developing world. It would simply mean that those countries that could compete most would benefit most. But this in itself is perhaps exactly what you want to achieve. Another principle that I would probably push is to link the aid with a whole set of measures and perhaps resources which the country, which the recipient countries would have to undertake. In other words, to have a kind of a matching principle. If country X receives aid, then it also ought to allocate a certain amount of its own resources to the same project or to the same institution. Try to encourage a process whereby foreign aid becomes a way of encouraging self-help. And I think in the past, too often, this has not been the case, that aid was very much a substitute for domestic resources, and in this sense did not benefit from the kind of package which domestic resources plus foreign aid could have had. Well, I'm very glad that I changed over a 25-year period. I think it would be rather distressing if I hadn't learned anything in 25 years. I'm not sure what you're referring to, so I can't give you a specific answer. But I think it's very clear that aid projects per se are going to be that much more successful if they are multidisciplinary. Now, there's no doubt in my mind. I tried to make the case. I don't know how successfully, but if one were to undertake an evaluation of aid projects and do it in a very systematic way, I'm convinced that one would find that those projects that have been most successful were projects which in a way cut across a narrow discipline. That's the only point that I'm making. I'm making another point, which is that given the type of interactive system which we have in development, that if you really want to understand this process of economic, social development, one has to look at it from the viewpoint of many disciplines and not just one. No, I agree. I agree entirely with you. I mean, the problem with dealing with topics as broad as the one that I have dealt with is that if you had to make all the qualifications that you probably would want to make, it would take you the first 2 hours, and you'd never get to the heart of the topic. When we talk about the South, of course, we're not talking about a homogeneous block, a homogeneous group of country. And in fact, the range of income which it covers is enormous. Well, one distinction that I did make was between the low-income countries, which are fairly homogeneous, countries with less than $300 per capita income per year. But if you take the middle-income country, that goes from 300 to above 4,000. Now, that is a tremendous range. There, I'm not sure that the distinction is necessarily a north South one within the South. I think it's much more a difference in terms of the various continents. If you look at Latin America, you see a certain pattern of a certain structure of development, a certain approach to development, which is very different from what one finds, let's say, in Pakistan, India, Bangladesh. And again, if one turns to East Asia, the Koreas of this world, the Taiwan of this world, the Japan in its own development period in the 19th century. Again, one find a very different approach to development. I agree with you, but still, it seems to me if one could achieve no more than making the truly rich industrialized countries of the world aware of some of the benefits of development cooperation, of the long-run benefits, I think this might be a very important step to perhaps the next step, which would be to see that within the South itself, one made some of the richer countries in the South aware of their responsibilities vis-a-vis the poor ones. I mean, you could have some kind of a cascade effect, but clearly the richer among the poor countries today, if they see that the Western world is doing very little, feel that it provides them with a rationale, if not an excuse for not doing anything. Well, I'm not sure. My impression is a great deal. Academic and semi-academic institutes. I think a number of the health medical advances. Well, I mentioned malaria eradication. This has been a very successful program for a long time. Now, malaria seems to be coming back today. But for many years, you had whole countries which in which malaria was eradicated. Well, this was very much a product of university research. The Green Revolution, the high-yielding varieties, this is very much a product of the international centers, the International Wheat and Corn Institute in Mexico, the International Rice Institute in the Philippines. I think many of the advances which have taken place and which have benefited directly the developing countries have had a link to universities. I'm sure there might be something of this type. And I probably put it much too strongly when I indicated that that some advances might not be dependent on just one individual in one discipline. Clearly, it's possible. But I was really thinking more of the application and the adaptation of research to concrete situation. It seems to me that there you have to have a multidisciplinary approach.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Thorbecke, and thank you all for coming. I hope to